It's a really ambitious show, but I got it. Oh man, I just blew into the mic on that. It's a really ambitious. It's a really ambitious shit. I'm like drooling here. Hold on. It's a really ambitious show. Fuck it. Everybody, you're listening to the Comic Book Bears podcast. I'm Billy Z.
I'm Brian Pittard.
And I'm Steve Morgan.
And we're coming to you with our first show since we saw each other. And if you guys are friends with us, you know that you saw these beautiful pictures of the three of us around custom cars that we all attended the Heroes Con in Charlotte, North Carolina. And, of course, it was great to see you guys. I stayed with Steve, and Brian joined us in Charlotte a few days later. It was great seeing everybody and people from the EOC boards, and I've just come to really enjoy that con.
It's so good. Such a great show.
It's so nice to be able to actually have time to talk to a lot of artists and creators out there and just really get to know people.
Yeah.
Unlike, you know, the big media cons where it's just lines and it's loud and it's hard to really, you know, engage with people. But, Heroes Con is all about that engagement process.
Yeah. And it's a great con if you are into original art. I think it's probably the best con out there for that. If you were just into a shopping show, has a lot to offer there. You know, and we certainly enjoyed ourselves at the Hyatt Bar. after and so certain creators that we've had longtime relationships with, and we're not going to go through a full recap of that because I'll admit, I think everybody will admit, it's not the most exciting radio if you consider this an analog to radio, but a good time was had by all, and I am certain we will be there next year. So if you want to run into us as a group, that's one of your really good chances, is at Heroes Con. So, well, there's been a couple of things a brewing within the comic book world, and the things brewing are weddings. So what we decided to do on this episode is cover the big wedding issues that have recently come out. But we're going to start with some discussion about the wedding issues that were probably the first ones we were aware of, and then also our favorites. So if you hate weddings, scram. You know, there's nothing we can do about that. But again, between Batman number 50 and X-Men 29 and 30, do I have the numbers right, gentlemen?
Yeah.
30 was the actual wedding.
What is this, X-Men Gold?
Yes, X-Men Gold.
Yeah.
For somebody who's a civilian, it's so hard to follow this stuff. We will be talking about those issues, but as I just said, we're going to start with the first wedding issues that we were aware of as readers and fans. Now, usually I throw the mic over to you gentlemen first, but I'm taking it the first time because I'm old as sand. So my first wedding has to be the first in line. So this involves a character that is near and dear to Brian's heart, and it comes from December of 1973 when I first started reading comics when I was 6 years old. This is, I believe, my first full Kirby issue, and the book that I'm talking about is Mr. Miracle number 18, which was the final issue in that original run, and within that issue we saw the marriage of Mr. Miracle and Big Barda. And it basically threw all of the New Gods characters apart from the Forever People into the mix. So I had an introduction to everybody from Granny Goodness to Light Ray. Kirby to a six-year-old is pretty friggin' weird. But it stayed with me, naturally. You know, the characters stayed with me. And seriously, this was like within my first 2 or 3 months reading. And that was my first. Brian, what was yours?
So I had only been reading comics for a couple years in the early to mid-90s, and I was reading the X-Men, of course, fairly consistently. In fact, of all the different DC and Marvel books that I was reading. The X-Men books were definitely the linchpin. And I started, I think, with it was around the time of Uncanny something or other. What was the one with the Claremont gatefold? I remember Professor X had that crazy outfit headgear, and it was like the end of a Lilandra Starjammers adventure kind of thing.
Oh yeah, that was right before they split the teams into the gold and
yes.
blue team.
They split. So yeah, yeah. Right before X-Men Volume 2, Number 1, came out, and I had been reading the end of what I've been realized is the end of the X-Factor run with the original five X-Men. And I loved them. Obviously, I knew who they were, but it was a little confusing because I was like, wait a minute. You know, they're X-Factor, not X-Men. So it was kind of an odd introduction to the whole thing. And all I had ever known of the X-Men prior were the cartoon and maybe just from other things. But anyway, long story short, fast forward ahead, issue 30 of X-Men Volume 2 with a great, amazing cover of, I believe it was Jim Lee, drawing actually was it Jim Lee? Hold on, I will tell you in a second. Drawing the wedding, at last, the wedding of Scott Summers and Jean Grey. And just amazing. I mean, very monumental moment. Oh, cover artist, Andy Kubert did that cover. Monumental moment in the lives of those two after being separated, and you know, Jean Grey being dead and just this and that. They never got to get a chance to have their wedding until finally that issue. So I don't remember a lot about the issue. I do remember that I think Jean and Scott leave the team at that point, go off, and they kind of take them off the shelf a bit, or they put them on the shelf rather. But yeah, that was definitely my first issue. And then I was like, wait a minute, comic book heroes get married? Like, it was a very surreal like realization that, you know, these characters who I obviously cared about had these like lives and sort of soap opera elements, and then culminated in such a big event. So that was my first wedding in a comic book.
And Steve, how about yours?
Well, mine was kind of odd. I was reading comics about the same time that Brian was reading, you know, pretty much between 89, 90, and 94. So I was actually reading X-Men about the same time. However, I had stopped picking up all the X books after all the very, very expensive, polybagged with trading cards, Executioner Song crossovers, and the holograms and all that garbage. So I had switched at that point by 94 to Sandman. So I missed, unfortunately, X-Men number 30 with that wedding issue. However, I, around this time, had become really a big fan of quarter box diving. So I would get into the four for a dollar bins and pull out just anything that looked interesting. And one of the things that I grabbed was a 1983 issue of the Legion of Superheroes annual number 2. I believe it was number 2. Might have actually been number 3. Nope, it was number 2 for sure. Which happened to be the wedding of Projectra and Karate Kid. Now, I didn't know too much about the Legion of Superheroes at this point. It was one of the first Legion books that I had picked up that was that took place in the 30th century. I had been reading Legion 90, 91, 92 up to that point. But, of course, that was a completely different generation of characters that I should have known the legacy characters at that point when I had started reading it, but of course I didn't, because I started pretty late. So a lot of these characters, of course, had corollaries in the Legion books, either because they were ancestors of those characters or somehow related to them. So this one was just really interesting, getting to know all of the different Legion characters that, of course, all more or less made an appearance in this book. Even if they were just guests for the wedding. But of course, you know, like every superhero wedding, something crazy happens. And, you know, before the wedding happens, a bunch of Legionnaires are, accidentally thrust backwards in time and end up fighting Greek gods because Superboy kind of made a mistake while he was you know, traveling through time. I guess he bumped them off course or something and somehow shot them back to, you know, to ancient Greece, where they ended up fighting a bunch of Greek gods who actually weren't Greek gods anyway. They were actually all Durlins, we found out later, who were just shapeshifted into Greek gods. Everything kind of happens. I think Brainiac solves the problem and brings everyone back to the 30th century, just in time to witness the wedding between Projector and Karate Kid. So, you know, it's just one of those kind of goofy, feel good, you know, like late Silver Age, early Bronze Age kind of transition comics where it's still kind of pretty innocent, but you're starting to move into the more interesting mid 80s where everything sort of kicks off into a grittier, you know, more confrontational thing. But of course, this was still pretty bubbly and it ends a little bit on a down note, but they still get married. And, you know, for them, it's supposed to be a semi happily ever after until, of course, you know, several issues later when other things happen.
Yeah.
but for me, I didn't read those other issues afterwards for quite some time. So I was like, well, this seems like a pretty happy go lucky book, and, you know, was able to get a bunch of other ones. But yeah, that's the first wedding issue that I read. And I seem to have missed every other big wedding in the 90s after that.
What other big weddings were there in the 90s apart from Superman and Lois? I'm trying to think. Naturally, Jean and Scott. Were there others?
I can't remember if it was in the No, you know what? It was in the late 2000s that North Star got married to his boyfriend, his fiancé. I'm trying to think what else.
Like 2011, happened. I think.
Yeah.
In terms of the early 2000s, one that I was very happy to see finally was Green Arrow and Black Canary.
Okay, yeah.
There were a lot of tongue-in-cheek issues around that time, and I think that's the best way to handle those characters in that situation. I just remember the wedding special being especially funny.
Well, and then, of course, you had in the 2000s, you had Storm and Black Panther.
Oh, yeah.
And I know we've talked about that in the past.
With love, yeah.
Yeah. They had to retcon something in order to make it happen. So, you know, I guess they really put a lot of effort into it, a lot of work. But yeah, I mean, there's been some pretty big profile or at least pretty well-hyped weddings. I think one of the big ones that a lot of people remember is the Teen Titans wedding between Donna Troy and Terry.
Terry Long, and you have just transitioned over to me, because that is my favorite wedding issue of all time. The book in question is Tales of the New Teen Titans, number 50 from 1985. And this was just when I started getting back into comics. The Titans were the series that really spoke to me. You know, when I got back into comics, Crisis on Infinite Earths had just started. I see that it's the same team. I had gotten the first few issues of New Teen Titans, but I don't even think I read them. I mean, that's how disinterested I was in comics through most of 1980. I collected all the back issues in very quick succession, and that wasn't the cheapest proposition at that time with New Teen Titans. I mean, now there's a handful of issues like number 2 with the first appearance of Deathstroke, which is in a very big ticket book, and DC Comics presents number 26, which has the first appearances of the three new members. But some of them were more than a buck, let's put it that way. I just love the issue because there's, apart from Terry bowing down to Hippolyta, there's no action in the story whatsoever. It's just a celebration of the Titans as friends. And for somebody who was 17 at the time when that came out, there's a sequence in there's two very touching sequences in the book. One is when Donna tells Dick that she loves him and he says he loves her back. And for me, that was, you know, when you're becoming an adult, you know, seeing an expression of true love that's not sexualized, that's not romantic. Wolfman and Perez, they just got that vibe so well. And you had appearances from all the Titans from the 60s and 70s and 80s within the book. A really poignant moment at the time in the Batman books, Bruce was going through the first steps of trying to adopt Jason Todd. And Dick Grayson asked Bruce straight out, "How come you never adopted me?" And the response is realistic. It fits the characters. It's more than a wedding issue in the sense that almost every Titan has their moment in some way. apart from them getting married to a John Denver song in 1984, it basically all rang true. And it's also just exquisitely drawn. I mean, it's one of my favorite art jobs from George Perez ever. And again, you know, it's not a superhero issue. The characters basically don't even appear in costume throughout the issue, to the best of my recollection. I can pull it up on digital because that was one of my first buys when that became available. But that is my favorite Wedding issue. That's Tales of the New Teen Titans number 50. Bryan, how about you? What's your fave?
So you guys already mentioned it. Astonishing X-Men number 51 was when Firestar, Northstar, married his boyfriend. And admittedly, like, this storyline had kind of been building for a while in the book. So, you know, we all knew it was sort of coming. And the book at the time, it wasn't like the most amazing book in a lineup. One of the covers I'm looking at has Northstar, Gambit. Was that Wild Child? No. Who was the
that, like, almost Asgardian chick? I don't know.
Yeah, I think she was.
I forget who she was.
From the what's the race that Lalandra comes from? I know my brain's not working.
Oh, Shi'ar.
The Shi'ar. Shi'ar,
yeah. And Wolverine, and it looks like Hisako, and Iceman's back there in the background. That's interesting. But yeah, like, it was okay. I think I have to check here, but I think that was Greg Pak writing.
Marjorie Louis, or Lou. I believe.
Oh, is it Marjorie? Or, oh, you're right. You're right. No,
am I right? Yeah.
It was Marjorie.
Yeah, Greg Pak was the writer on it before.
That's what it was. So I think he, like, started, like, and sort of laid down some of the underpinnings of it, and then she wrote the second half. But I mean, here's the thing. Like, X-Men are obviously sort of metaphor for a lot of things, and the dispossessed and the minority and all that. And having gay characters and dealing with the mutant subject matter in general was really quite nice and impressive, and it meant a lot to a gay comic book reader, especially someone who followed the X-Men like I did. And so, you know, I kind of look past the other stuff, the writing just not being resonating to me other than that, because the story, I think the villains were kind of weird. And the issue itself, I do remember there being some sort of hijinks that, like, you know, they almost didn't get married, and that's sort of interesting. But then they do, and it's sweet. It's really nice. It kind of neutered, I hate saying this, kind of neutered Northstar. I don't think they did a whole lot more with him over the years. Not that they couldn't have easily undone that or worked around that. I mean, I think the whole trope of, oh, you marry off a superhero and that kind of takes away their mojo, or takes away their interestingness as a character, I don't buy that as much.
Oh, not at all.
But because, yeah, I think it's just a writing challenge. Yeah, you know, you just make it work. But,
and I will take married Superman over unmarried Superman any day.
Of course. And, you know, well, there's, you know, well, we don't want to get into current events with what's going on in Man of Steel, but there's certainly a whole conversation there that could be had. But, like, no, just, it was a great issue. It meant a lot to me and a lot of my friends in my community. 2012, which is the year that it came out, was also one of the first years that I was doing podcasting in the you know, queer space. I don't remember, were we doing Comic Book Bears in 2012, or was it the next year?
We were doing it in 2011. I think you came on in 2012.
That sounds right. Yeah. Then, so yeah, and I had started Flame On in 2011, and yeah, anyway, it all sort of was in that same era.
Oh no, it was April 2012 was when we started, so so it was around like right around that time. Yeah,
so I mean, like, there was a lot of kind of queer, geeky continuity things coalescing in the universe around this. So it was quite an important moment in just, you know, many things. And of course, you know, gay marriage was recognized in a few states, including New York, where I believe this happened. But I mean, not that it had to be, but you know what I mean. So, you know, I feel like this has to be my favorite just for that reason alone.
Okay, just diverging a little bit from the marriage issue. Do you guys have any situations where there was gay content in a comic that really had an effect on you? Because I can certainly say that was the case for me with the queer bashing issues of Green Lantern. From that point, I was much more open at work and in some other situations because of the resonance of that story. And Do you guys have any of that, or?
Steve, what about you?
Not really, no.
I was going to say, I'm really struggling because so much of the comic book experience for me wasn't queer, or if there were queer stories, I wasn't out early on. It wasn't out until, like, you know, the late 90s, and so, or, well, I guess mid to late 90s. But anyway, like, yeah, no, honestly, nothing really spoke to me. I think until, like, North Star was probably one of the first characters that I knew was gay, and that was cool. And I don't know who the next character was. I mean, for a long time, you got, like, North Star, and then who was it in DC?
DC, you had pretty much secondary characters.
Right.
You know, Maggie Sawyer and Extrano. Tasmanian Devil was gay.
And then
the
character, is it on JSA?
Obsidian,
yeah. I think for me, because, again, I had stopped reading superhero, superhero comics, sort of by the mid-90s, and, like, everything I picked up was all, you know, either a Vertigo title or, you know, autobiographical. I had actually started reading queer characters outside of a superhero context, so if you're talking about, you know, queer characters in general, Sandman had the character of Foxglove and her girlfriend Danny, I think, who made their first real appearance in Doll's House and A Game of You, and that kind of midstream in Sandman. So, like, they kept coming back in you know, later issues of Death, The High Cost of Living, and, or not The High Cost of Living,
Time of Your
One
Life.
Of the Death, Time of Your Life.
Yeah.
So, you know, those were the queer characters I knew. Not necessarily queer men, but, you know, queer women, queer characters there. And then, of course, some autobiographical stuff. You know, there's always somebody in an indie comic who has a friend who's a gay character, you know, that kind of thing. So it's, you know, for superheroes, reading them regularly didn't happen until, for me, the 2000s.
Yeah. The reason I brought that Green Lantern up is that after reading that story, I wanted people to know exactly who they were dealing with. It's strange that it was from a comic, because anything that really had big influences on me, you know, it hasn't been from this realm. I don't know. It was just an interesting observation that I can at least pinpoint being more open at work and more open socially from how that story hit me. Okay, Steve, since we're still on this subject, what was your favorite wedding issue?
My favorite wedding issue actually happened, and it took me a little while to jog my memory. In fact, I was still thinking about it when we started. But it was actually Wonder Woman's wedding with Hades. And I'm not going to say marriage, because clearly they didn't end up getting married. But basically, I believe it was like Wonder Woman, the New 52 Wonder Woman number 9. Where she is basically killed, quote unquote, and has to come down to Hades, where Hades, who is her uncle, ostensibly, decides that he's going to marry her. And so she basically goes through all these motions, kind of deciding who she is and what she represents. And of course, you know, the way that it's drawn, of course, is just absolutely gorgeous. You know, the final wedding itself. And of course, she finds her loophole to get out of it and not marry Hades, yet still be able to get out of the underworld. But it's just it's a kind of exciting weapon, exciting marriage. We're a real counterpoint to the Teen Titans marriage. This one has actually a good amount of action in it and a lot of tension, because, of course, you don't want them to get married. You don't want this to happen. Hades has kind of created this weird deal, this weird bargain that really she can't get out of, but then she finds the way and is able to escape and looks fabulous doing it, because Cliff Chang is an amazing artist. That's one I'd recommend. Wonder Woman number 9 from the New 52 run. Is just it's cool, it's weird, it's bizarre. Her wedding dress is definitely very unique among the other wedding dresses here. I'm not sure if anybody was able to pull up a picture, but if you do, it's basically a blood red gown with a bunch of severed hands hanging off of it and some spikes around the collar. So it looks pretty dang cool, but also pretty pretty gross.
It's close to Spiked Collar of Rachel Phoenix, I thought.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay, well, I threw the X-Men out there. Steve, Brian, I don't know who wants to go first, but why don't you tell me what went down in the X-Men books with the, at the very least, planned wedding of Peter and Kitty. Or
Pewter. Well, Brian, how about you talk about this? I know one of the things I did want to mention while we were talking before the show is that your first major wedding issue was, adjectiveless X-Men number 30, where Scott and Jean get married. This so happens to be X-Men Gold number 30, where it's the wedding of Kitty and Pyotr, which I thought was kind of interesting symmetry. And I wonder if
that was a great catch. I didn't even think. I mean, I don't know if it was planned to. I don't know. You assume that they were at least aware that that was a synchronicity if it wasn't a planned one. So this is another book that I have been pretty outspoken about my not enjoying. In fact, I have to buy it because Pat reads it, and that means that I will at least have it in my app. And so when I travel, as is my wont, if I'm flying, I will binge through and just sort of like get it out of my system and clear it off my tablet. So I've not loved everything that they've done in this issue, the series. But I will say that this issue of The Wedding, written by Mark Guggenheim, art by, oh God, I just had his name and it flew out of my head. Bendis artist, primarily recently.
David Marquez?
Yes, thank you. David Marquez, first of all, lovely human being, super nice. Been to Heroes Con a few times, and that was where I met him.
Yeah, I met him in New York when he was doing the what was the 3D book he had?
The Joiners in 3D. Yeah.
And I won a contest, so I got one of his sketchbooks.
Oh wow! I mean, he is a powerhouse, and he is like blossomed more and more. And Bendis has obviously utilized him as much as he can. So this issue is first of all gorgeous. There are a few, and I mean very few areas or panels rather that are a little sketchy. You're like, okay, you had to rush through this. I mean, go back and look, there's some problems, but overall, like just absolutely gorgeous. Just so good. So it's a gorgeous book, but, the wedding of, Pyotr and, my brain's just totally not firing tonight.
Kitty,
yeah. Kate, gotcha. gotcha. Not Zamora, not the drag queen. So they have been courting for, I mean, they have relationship going back decades at this point. And the wedding is imminent. And Ileana, Piotr's sister, is kind of like, doing the whole, say best man. Maid of honor for Katya, or Katie. I don't know where I got that. Anyway, hanging out, talking, drinking, sort of decompressing, and then like, I just can't tell you. I just have a secret. I just can't tell you. And there's a dramatic moment up on a roof somewhere, and it's like, what is it? What the hell? What's going on? And it's like, I don't think you guys are right for each other. Basically, I don't think you should get married. And she says this like out of nowhere. Okay. I mean, they've been nothing that would ever suggest this otherwise. There's a reason for this in a little bit. I'll get back to. And then, the wedding day comes. They have everybody and their brother there. It's this beautiful outdoor wedding. You know, Kitty's got like the three women who raised her, and I recognized two of the three.
Mm-hmm.
But the third one I didn't. Did you guys catch that, or did you know who that third person was? It was like Storm, and my brain's not working, and somebody else who I just never heard of. But anyway,
was she the reporter that basically
maybe
followed them around in like the 80s? I think was dating or involved with Beast at one point.
That's Trish Tilby.
Okay,
remember that it was not Trish. Anyway, point is, for Surrounded by Love, the wedding is just going to be beautiful. It's this epic thing. And she gets up there, and they're like, do you? And Kitty phases. So, like, right as Piotr's putting the ring on her, she phases. And at first I'm sitting there thinking, oh, she's stuck. She's phasing. She can't control it. They're going to be married, but they can't touch each other. And I was like, oh, that's really sad. This is just like the initial first thought. Because I just didn't think right off the bat, oh, they're just not going to get married. I don't know why I didn't think that, but whatever. And then, of course, she falls through the earth to get out of there. Like, I'm out of here. And they talk later, and it's like, oh, I love you, but we haven't done it by now. I just don't know why we wouldn't. And it was this whole, like, I mean, so Guggenheim did his best that he could to handle this. From what it has been reported, Marvel editorial pulled this idea sort of at some point. It may not be last minute, but at some point they said, you know, we don't want this to happen. After I think they had already started sort of working down this path. Because I don't think, I don't know. They might have originally, or they might have kept going down this path even if they said otherwise, but my understanding was Guggenheim wanted them to get married, and Marvel editorial said no. So he swerves into the reception, and the reception actually is kind of hilarious because you've got like old Jean, young Jean, Rachel all talking and looking very similar. And they're like, oh, it's so much pain. They're all reacting kind of like almost like cuckoos a little bit. They had a very – I was like, wait, are the cuckoos getting red hair or something now? And then I'm like, oh, yeah, I'm an idiot. I was speed reading this thing. But no, like, out of nowhere, seemingly, some conversation's happening with Gambit about what's going on, and he's sitting there thinking and sort of looking weird and looks back over at Rogue longingly and – then he proposes to Rogue out of, not nowhere, because they've had a long relationship off and on. And they have also had, most recently, a very good miniseries that started out kind of weak sauce, and it got so much better by the end. And definitely enjoyed their reuniting. So they get married instead, because everybody else is there. It's a free wedding. Might as well. and so then, but then the nice thing is at the end of the issue, they had a very adult moment between Peter and Kitty. And again, given that this is sort of a swerve that wasn't probably organic to the storyline, Guggenheim did his best and it kind of works. And of course, then the fallout after that is, Peter's going to be like, I'm leaving. I'm not going to stick around here if you don't want to be with me. Cause I think that in the next issue, it's like Kitty says something like, I love you. And Peter's like, don't say that to me. Like, how can you say that to me after what just happened? Like I can't deal with this. I can't even. and then leaves. So I don't know. It was not that the trope of a wedding swerve is unheard of, but, and it was, like I said, beautifully drawn, but just, it was a little weird for me. I don't know. But the Rogue Gambit thing is nice. They're going to have a new book now, Mr. and Mrs. X. They're going to go off and have sexy adventures together, which as again, old school, like 90s, not old school, but 90s X-Men fan, I'm a little excited about.
Well, I mean, that's the thing with this is that it felt, they're trying to, I guess, feed a little bit of nostalgia with the relationship of Gambit and Rogue becoming the central romantic X-Men partnership. There is Nightcrawler and Phoenix, but Nightcrawler and Rachel. But guess what? That was kind of explored in Excalibur in the 90s a little bit.
Did they actually date in that book? I don't think so.
I think they had a very intimate friendship.
They were close, but I don't remember.
I don't remember. I was just so focused on Bryan and Megan.
Because that was the big central romance of that book was that. Bryan and Megan was unsure, blah, 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 blah. But, but Rachel and Nightcrawler, they've known each other forever. And of course, they've been kind of having this relationship throughout X-Men Gold that's been coming up. So I think that was to have Rogue and Gambit be the new couple, the new it couple is kind of. I don't know. I mean, I'm not the biggest Rogue and Gambit fan. Even though I, the 90s X-Men were my introduction to X-Men, but it is what it is. And of course, Mr. and Mrs. X is the big mystery book that they've been pushing for the past couple of months.
Which I was so disappointed by. Like, I'm excited that they're going to do that book, but when they had this big mystery, I kept thinking, they're going to bring Scott back finally. Oh, because I'm all, this is now a nostalgia thing, if I may. Like, X-Men Gold has been the biggest pile of shit because it's just such X-Men porn. Like, and not in a fun and sexy way. Like, just the most nostalgic. Like, do you remember that was X-Men 92 book that Bowers and Sims did? Like, that was honest about being X-Men porn. Like, just honest. And you knew what you were getting. But it didn't matter because it really was sort of a weird thing from Battle World and then kept going for some reason. But, like, Gold is...
It was a total fan service.
Yeah. And I... Okay, I'll be honest. I may have said this before on the show. I know I've said it on other shows. I don't think Mark Guggenheim is the best comic book writer in the world.
I totally agree with you. I can't think of a single comic that I would recommend that he wrote.
And that's kind of where I'm at.
Yeah.
Now, television, totally different story. And I think what that is... So when I say he's not a good writer, I shouldn't say he's not a good writer. He's a great writer. His tone in the X-Books... It's not the tone I want. His tone, I think he's on, was he writing for Flash? I know he's written for, like, a couple of the WB shows.
I think he's written for all of the shows apart from Black Lightning.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
In some context.
So his Flash and his other stuff, excellent, great, perfect for those shows' tone. But, this book is just, to me, it's hot garbage. It's ending soon, and I cannot wait. Because so what's really funny is Blue has been, Blue started as a fairly good complement to Gold because Blue was the new adventures of the original X-Men, time displaced young X-Men. And even though that conceits whatever, I have issues with that, but you know, I've been
all new X-Men.
Yeah. Okay. all new X-Men. I remember that, but no, like the at least, is it Colin Bunn for a while? I think, for most of it, like it's been okay. It's been interesting enough. It, you know, Magneto's in the mix. That's cool. You know, you got all this space adventure stuff. I don't know. At least there was some new stuff going on, some good gimmicks, but still exploring those classic X-Men themes and involving classic X-Men, and it worked. But oh my God, I would just between the two books back and forth. And I was just like, oh, come on. Just no. Why is this so bad? Why does Marvel think? And I mean, I don't know what the sales numbers are like for this book, at least for Gold versus Blue. Just no. Anyway, so I don't know. I'm done ranting. My opinion is known. Gold is garbage, but it's ending, and then we'll get whatever comes next.
Again, I'm a civilian right now. What is X-Men Red?
Jean Grey's book.
Okay.
Yeah. It's basically Jean Grey takes a very select group of X-Men characters, including X-23, Honey Badger, and Nightcrawler. Honey Badger. I love Honey Badger. She's
Scabby's my character.
What's Namor. Jonathan? Jonathan came with them, so Jonathan's also part of the team, technically.
Ooh.
Chamber?
No, Jonathan.
Who the hell is Jonathan?
He's Gabby's pet actual Wolverine.
Okay.
And then also a new character who's an Indian girl that they rescued who has
Trinary?
Yes, she has the power to not just control machines, but repurpose the algorithms and the AI, which is useful in the current storyline. But yeah, it's the Cassandra Nova working behind the scenes to turn the entire world against mutants.
Yeah, it's been good. It's got some maybe heavy-handedness about it, but that and Astonishing X-Men have both been far more solid. Again, still bringing back fan favorites. I mean, doing things that is sort of fan service-y in a way, but just not pandering and being like gross about it, which is how I feel Gold is. I mean, the fact that they moved the stupid mansion into Central Park in New York City is to this day, I think it's just the dumbest thing I've ever seen them do. And I wasn't a fan, at least at first, of them putting the X-Mansion or Jean Grey, whatever, in limbo. I thought that was kind of whatever, but that made sense at least in some ways, and they made it work.
So now you have the Xavier Mansion, Avengers Mansion, and the Baxter Building within like a 7-mile radius.
Oh, and don't forget about Attilan.
Oh,
Attilan is still somewhere in
that's whatever, though. I mean, like, that shit moves around every whatever. And, I mean, the mansion they rebuilt all the damn time. But, like, when they started moving it, it's like, okay.
Stop. Like, how many times can they blow it up?
Oh, that can just, like, for that's just a trope at this point. I mean, and that's a lot of – that's not just that. I mean, other headquarters –
that's an even more desperate trope than the Savage Land.
Well, yeah.
You're not
wrong. Gee, aren't they going to go back to Australia anytime soon?
Seriously, it's a, they're due. Right?
For the 80s.
Yeah, they should be. Put the mansion in Australia. Put it in Sydney Harbor.
Oh, God.
That'd be cool.
Imagine.
I have a few questions about the issues.
Please.
Wedding guests, did they include Pete Wisdom and Star-Lord?
Not that I saw.
No. However, Phil Noto on the cover did make sure to include Star-Lord.
Oh, I didn't even notice that.
Yeah, he's off in the corner. They basically had it was an interesting grouping of characters. You have the original time-displaced all-new X-Men in the back. You've got some of the newer X-Men. You have the Thing, randomly.
Well, everybody likes Ben.
I guess. You know, some. You have a couple, I think, Magan and Brian, Captain Britain, are there. But, you know, randomly, Gamora and Star-Lord. But, yeah, it's an interesting... it's an interesting mix on the cover. I actually like the cover, seeing all those characters in there. But by the way, the other woman, the third woman in there, is Stevie Hunter.
Who is that?
She was a peripheral human character who, I guess, she ran a dance studio at one point and then somehow became the X-Men security expert slash psychologist. And according to this, she's become a congresswoman or something.
Oh, Lord.
She's always been used. Anytime they needed a human, it was either Stevie Hunter or Moira McTaggart, who would be, you know, the human character who would either back him up or be the weak link. And it just depended on where they were, because Stevie Hunter's from New York, while Moira would be off, you know, wherever else they were. Cool. So, yeah, I mean, once I saw her name, I was like, Stevie, where do I know that name? And I did some, I dug a little bit of it, and I'm like, oh, I remember her from random issue number 12 and random X-Men 290 whatever, and yeah.
Okay, well, let's move over to the other side of the street, and the other big wedding issue was Batman number 50. Now, Steve, I know you haven't read it yet. Brian, mm-hmm. Have you?
Oh, yes.
Okay. Well, I'll take people through it, and then you can interject. And as everybody knows, and Steve, there's elements that are going to be spoiled. You're okay with that because you already know the big spoil, right?
Yeah, I'm not too concerned about that.
Okay. All right. So what the issue basically is, and I got to say that this was a real testament to Tom King's writing. A big portion of the book is effectively a poster gallery of different artists' interpretations of the Bat and the Cat. You see Selina and Bruce after all these shenanigans have happened with the Joker in the previous two issues and the various prelude to the wedding issues where everybody seemed to fight everybody. You have Bruce and Selina making their final plans. Now, in the comics, it's not Bruce and Selina who are getting married. It's Batman and Catwoman, with Selina being basically publicly known as Catwoman, how that might affect Bruce's life. You don't know this till the end, but the narrative is, for the most part, letters that each of them have written to each other. Some of the gallery-type splash pages are beautiful. I thought that the one, Brian, I don't know if you'll agree with me, but the one that Amanda Connor did of Bruce and Selina in the zoo with the tigers.
Oh, I love it.
Oh, my God, I love that. But somehow, King weaves these into a really effective and tight storyline of the final preparations for the wedding, including the theft and alterations of the wedding gown, a beautifully touching moment between Bruce and Alfred in relation to who will be the best man, all the indications prior to that it was Clark. And what happens is Catwoman leaves him at the altar, for lack of a better word. He leaves them there to protect him. Now, there have been some lead up into this. A very strong component of that lead up was Booster Gold's robot Skeets, showing what the future would look like without Bruce's Batman. And we have a really big cliffhanger kind of gut punch at the end where Holly, Catwoman's friend, is currently incarcerated in Arkham Asylum and goes to report back because she kind of pushed Selina into this direction of skipping out on the wedding. And you see Bane with a host of characters and echoes of Nightfall where Bane says the bat is broken. You have to wonder, like, some of the characters, why they're there. And Tom King has said the Bruce and Selina storyline is going to run through his entire planned 100 issues. So there's a lot of story left to tell. I did think that last page was pretty close to a shocker. So we're not going to have a married Batman and Catwoman. Catwoman series premiered the same day. I haven't read that yet. Bryan, anything you want to add in relation to the wedding issue there?
I just think you're spot on. It was heartbreaking, but sort of makes sense. And like a lot of people were saying, they're like, oh, they're never going to do it. They're never going to do it. But it is interesting that Tom King's thing is like, this is the halfway point. Like, this is not the finale. This is not the end. This just sort of shakes up the ant farm, if you will, and new stories will come out of it. The Bane thing kind of surprised me and made me go, huh? But you know, we'll see what happens with it. It's early, too early to say what that's about. But no, I love it. Tom King is a great writer. The only thing, and the iFanboy guys kind of called this really, really well, is as much as I love the pinups and as much as I love the narrative structure, it went on a little long. He probably have boiled it down a bit more.
I would agree with that. I would definitely agree with that. Yeah.
Like, I hate when I catch myself and my short attention, you know, span acting up, if you will. But this issue definitely taxed me. And that's not, like, that's me saying that as a comic book reader. So I feel like it's fairly indicative of other comic book readers. But obviously, there are people who could read that whole thing and be very entertained and appreciate it. And it's just beautiful prose. He did a really cool thing with the structure and everything. So I give my hats off to Tom King for that and finding all those. So I don't know, were they all original? I mean, most of them I think were, but like the Frank Miller one, I wasn't sure if that was.
I think they're all original.
A reuse.
Yeah, I think they're all.
Oh, original. Wow. Okay.
And so, you know, I mean, the Neil Adams one, you know.
Oh, gosh. Oh,
beautiful.
The Weeks.
Lee Weeks.
Like, there's just so many good things in there that, like, it's a real, and you mentioned like the choice was really kind of a sacrifice. Like it's Catwoman recognizing what she is doing and sacrificing her own happiness and Batman's as well in many ways to keep the world safer and allow this to. So yeah, it's great. I will say also, I did read the new Catwoman number one written and drawn by Joelle Jones. It's interesting. I don't know that I love it. I love Joelle Jones' art normally. There's some interesting stylistic things she's doing that I don't know that I love. But I'm probably going to stay with it because I realize that thinking way back, I was a pretty big Catwoman fan back in the day, probably around when Batman Returns came out and, you know, other things, of course, but just having her back in the Bat family sort of as an important part of Batman's life is really cool. And I missed it and I didn't realize that I missed it over the last few issues or the last however many issues. But yeah, I'm going to probably keep up with that to see what happens in that book.
Yeah, I definitely think that Catwoman could support an ongoing. Certainly has in the past. She just hasn't been too well served by some of the choices over the last, I'd say, 10 years or so.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Although I do have to say her new 52 book, I think, lasted in
52. Yeah, 50, it lasted issues, the 52, yeah. But yeah.
Well, 52 plus zero.
There was some weird shit in there, you know, when she became the crime boss of Gotham. And
oh, yeah, that was almost weird.
There was some weird stuff where it just even if the particular issue wasn't bad, it didn't feel like a Catwoman book after Winnick's initial run. I know a lot of people had issues with that first issue where the implication was that they had sex and left their masks on. But at least it felt like a Catwoman book. I think as the series went on, a lot of that dissipated where it just didn't have the feel of Selina I mean, it's a really complex character, and there's a lot of things you can do with her. I don't know. I don't think she's been served really well since Brubaker was on her.
How old is Catwoman? You know, not in terms of what her character's age is, but yeah. How long has she been around?
When since was 19, she was in Batman number one since 1940.
1940.
Yeah.
Oh. Yeah. So she's had almost the same, you know, the same longevity as Batman.
Oh yeah. Out of the Bat characters, only I think Joker, Hugo Strange, Gordon, and Dick Grayson are older in terms of Batman supporting characters. Yeah.
You know, and if you want to marry Batman and Catwoman, you can just look at you know, Earth 2 Justice Society.
And that's a beautiful story. If you ever have an opportunity to read the Earth 2, the Wedding of Batman and Catwoman from the old Brave and the Bold run, there's a writer, Alan Brennert. He's only written a handful of comic book stories, but and his batting average is amazing. There isn't a single story that he's written that wasn't top-notch. There's a Christmas story involving Supergirl and Deadman right after Crisis on Infinite Earths that is so beautiful. I think they collected all of his stories in one book, or at least all of his Batman stories. It's one of those Steranko situations where he has very limited output, but it's all really quality stuff. So I think he's mostly a TV writer. I think he was older though, like, you know, I think he was like the showrunner for like Jake and the Fat Man or something, you know. But he would dip his toes occasionally in comics, and he wrote the principal story in the 500th issue of Detective, and definitely look into his stuff because it's all good. And again, as I said, one of the stories is the marriage of the Earth 2 Bruce and Selina from the very tail end of Brave and the Bold, the original Brave and the Bold series. Really good. Any other comics you guys want to talk about? You don't have to. Just want to throw that out there.
You know, a couple interesting comics that came up, and I'm not really going to go into them too much, but I did want to bring up Multiple Man number one came out very recently, which is the return of Jamie Madrox. Very interesting. I'm not sure which direction it's going to go, but it is nice to see him again.
It's going to go in a zany direction because it is a zany book.
Well, it's already zany. I mean, the last page alone is enough to highlight the possible zaniness of it.
Oh, yeah.
Of what kind of craziness is bound to happen. Yeah, I mean, it's interesting bringing him back.
But hold on. So when you say bringing him back, we have to be clear. It's not the one they killed off.
Okay, so
it's a dupe that they found.
Yeah. So the premise of the book is that, you know, obviously Madrox has been killed from the cloud of Terrigen mist that killed a whole bunch of other mutants. And apparently all of his duplicates also died because Jamie Prime died. However, this particular duplicate that they discover has been sort of holed away in this secret laboratory bunker. He's the smart Jamie Madrox looking for a cure for the Terrigen mist, apparently. So he's technically dying, but then time travel goofiness ensues, and he may or may not be. He may be, you know, a longer lasting Jamie, and maybe, who knows, because it's zany, maybe he'll turn out to be the actual Prime, or the new Prime, or whatever, because, you know, obviously they don't want him to die off in a couple issues, because that would just be silly. So that one is pretty interesting. The writer on that is it's Rosenberg, and I'm
Matt
not
sure. Rosenberg.
Matt Rosenberg. And then Andy McDonald was doing the art. Tamara Bonvillain was handling the colors on that one. And then also going back to good old Black Hammer universe, which I'm really loving. Jeff Lemire is, you know, retelling the whole Silver Age DC world, DC and Marvel together, kind of in a different way than Kurt Busiek's been telling his Astro City creations. But they've now jumped into the 30th century or close to it. Yep, the 31st
it's
century.
Their Legion.
Exactly. So they're in the 31st century. So their Legion, the Quantum League, is the sort of future superheroes on that in that universe. However, where the Quantum Age starts, because of course Lemire has to throw it away, is it's 25 years after the Legion has basically effectively been disbanded and banned because of a Martian invasion that presumably devastated the Earth, but then also led the Earth to become a fascist empire that's slowly exterminating alien life throughout the galaxy. So very, very interesting, of course, dark premise. But of course, if you've been reading Black Hammer at all, it's very dark, very emotional, and an interesting retelling of Silver Age DC and Marvel.
Since you mentioned Astro City, did you read Astro City 52?
I did not. It's actually right here in the pile next to my desk.
We'll have to cover that, just like we'll have to cover Ant-Man and the Wasp and a couple other things that we have to table till everybody's gone through them. Bryan, any other books you want to talk about?
I think the only one, since I alluded to it earlier, should probably just address is Man of Steel, number 6. So the whole run of Man of Steel is out. Did you guys, Bill, did you read that
up
yet?
Up to 5.
Okay. Okay. Well,
6 is so in the next DCBS box.
It's got some interesting moments. It certainly explains sort of where we're at. Mm-hmm. And there's some stuff I don't want to like say because it is kind of a shock, but I think the obvious thing is it sort of addresses where Lois and John are. And that is interesting because, like I was talking about earlier, the idea of married couples in comics and you can write them effectively is, I believe, true and has been done. But Bendis in this case decided instead of like just, you know, something really drastic, like they get divorced or they
never
kill
one
of, he didn't do any of that. He found a different way to shunt them off into sort of a side adventure, if you will. And,
which also affects
Supergirl
from what I understand as well, right?
Or is that
going to be in her first issue?
That might be in her first issue.
Okay.
I don't know. About
he kind of,
and
it's interesting. Some of the things he said is this is more to get caught up to Doomsday Clock, because he has a lot of his story ideas will not make sense until Doomsday Clock is finished.
Oh, really?
Interesting.
I'm not sure if it was Bleeding Cool or Newsarama, but he did have an interview. Adventures of Super Sons takes place before this happens, and getting certain characters off the grid for a little while was in part influenced by what the end game is with Doomsday Clock. So,
And that's kind of fine. I know Doomsday Clock's going to be it's had some delays and it's been pushed out, so it probably isn't going to finish until the end of the year, if not past. But I mean, you know, taking some people off the board for a little bit in comics terms, as long as they're not killing them off, quote unquote killing them off, I think is fine from a storytelling perspective.
Yeah,
because
that's the right way to do it.
Yeah, I mean, the interesting ways, I think it was in Action Comics recently before 1000, where Superman was bouncing around through time with Booster Gold. They had a complete other side story. Like he was off doing his own thing with Booster, potentially, you know, getting ready to erase his future and his marriage to Lois anyway. And meantime, Lois and John were off trying to rescue General Lane in some unknown African country. Having them kind of off doing different things is, you know, it's not a bad idea.
Yeah.
To allow Bendis to just focus on Superman for a bit and let Lois.
One thing I got to say, Bryan, is I thought that Bendis's Daily Planet was right on the money. He has the voices of those characters, Perry White in particular. I think his Perry White is like right on the money. And
yeah.
I will not mind if a good number of the Superman stories are Daily Planet based. He's presented a very nice flow in how a media operation like that engages itself in its community. I really enjoyed what went on at the Daily Planet, how they were nervous to talk about Clark, about where Lois is and all that stuff. There were other elements of the story that I wasn't as crazy about, or I didn't get the payoff yet. And again, I only read up to 5. It certainly does not have me worried.
Well, from what I understand, there's going to be 2 books, Superman and Man of Steel, or Action Comics, sorry. And Superman is about Superman, and Action Comics is about Clark. So that's the divide. And so I think you're going to see a lot of that in Action Comics, which is the Clark side, you know, the reporter side. And that is, I think, where Bendis is really going to get to some interesting stuff. So, and then there is a conceit at the end of issue 6 that I will not reveal. It is sort of almost a throwaway, but it is pretty important. And you know, we'll see how that plays out and what that means. But yeah, it was fun. It was a good end from something that I wasn't sure I would love as much. Overall, I think it was pretty good.
Okay, well, we're going to wrap this one up, and when we wrap an episode of the Comic Book Bears Up, we do so with a segment we call the Woofs of the Week segment, where we spotlight something, be it a comic book or a television program or a charitable initiative, a film, anything under the sun that we think you, fair listener, may be interested in sampling. I'm going to go over to Steve because I'm looking at his picture, and Brian has a call me instead as a Skype ID, so Steve's picture is much more inviting. Steve, what is your Woof of the Week?
Well, my Woof of the Week, again, is TV-based, and it's British TV-based. So if you've got any listeners over in the UK, you can definitely watch this on a weekly basis on BBC Two. For those of you who are in the US, I'm sure we can figure out some way to watch it. But I wanted to mention The Misadventures of Ramesh Ranganathan, and I can't pronounce his name correctly, but The Misadventures of Ramesh Ranganathan. He is a British comedian, writer, and host who's done a lot of TV over the past several years. Most recently, he went to had a whole series where he went down to Sri Lanka and southern India and just kind of saw places where his family's from and just kind of explored that way. In The Misadventures of Ramesh Ranganathan, he goes to the undesirable countries of the world, the so-called undesirable countries, and goes to understand why people don't like them, but also to find the wonderful things about them. So, of course, he goes to places like Haiti and Ethiopia that have a really bad reputation and finds the beauty and gets to know the people and what kind of interesting things they can find there. Of course, it's not all smiles and rainbows. He does also explore the reasons why a lot of people look at these countries and just kind of shake their heads and say, absolutely not. But it's called The Misadventures of Ramesh Ranganathan on BBC Two.
Cool. Let's go over to Brian. Brian, what is your Woof of the Week?
There's so much going on. There's so many things in my life right now that are taking me at different directions and cross purposes. But what I will say, what I will give up my woof time, if you will, is to the lovely time that I had in Charlotte and Asheville, it turns out. The weekend I was up in North Carolina for Heroes Con, I had lovely, lovely, lovely times with my fellow comic book bears. Thoroughly enjoyed our adventures and our misadventures on Friday and Sunday. And I thoroughly enjoyed my Saturday away from the show this year. It timed out perfectly that one of my favorite electronic synthesizer module developers, Make Noise, was celebrating 10 years in Asheville in their headquarters. And it is especially important right now in so many areas to pay attention to what's going on in politics. But one of the areas that I am sensitive to, because it is affecting something I've spent a lot of time with recently, is electronics, and specifically American-made electronics, synthesizers in this case. Moog Music put out a very impassioned plea, but they are not alone in this, that the tariffs that are currently being put in place, the trade war that is developing, has already started, it will crush American-made technology because so many of the constituent parts all come from China. There is no strong ecosystem for parts that are American-made. So we're talking like transistors and the really itty-bitty stuff, even if there is a vibrant community of American small business making electronics, and that community is what will really ultimately be destroyed if this trade war continues. So as much as I started with a great thing, and I want to give a shout out to my fellow comic bears and John, our friend from Charlotte, and everybody else we saw from the 11 o'clock comic board, and everyone. Is it not 11? Is it 11 o'clock or Around Comics? Which one is
11
it?
O'clock Comics.
Okay.
Yeah, Around Comics was Neesman's thing before 11 o'clock Comics.
Yeah. Okay. So, but the communities have kind of blended. Anyway,
yeah. Oh, yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
So I had such a great time. Angie Bagley, who is a dear friend and love her to death, and got to celebrate her birthday, and it was great. But seriously, if anything,
yeah, that was pretty interesting. Brian talking to Mark Bagley for 20 minutes before I knew it was Mark Bagley.
That is, I didn't realize that. Oh my gosh, he's quite a salty storyteller. I that was the most time I had spent with him too. I spent a lot of time with his daughter, but like, that was some pretty intense Mark Bagley. But no, the other thing, though, again, the trade war right now, it's hurting a lot of businesses and a lot of people's livelihoods. So American businesses and livelihoods. So if you're paying attention and you feel up to contacting your congressperson and expressing your concern about American jobs and American businesses, this is an excellent time to do so.
Okay, for my Wolf of the Week, it goes out to Head Over Heels, the musical. It's currently in previews on Broadway. It had an engagement pre-Broadway out in San Francisco at the Curran Theater. And the show is based around the music of the Go-Go's. But the storyline is not a jukebox musical a la Jersey Boys or one of those shows. The storyline is inspired by Sir Philip Sidney's 16th century pastoral romance, Arcadia. It's a really ambitious show, but it more than not hits the mark. Remarkably talented cast. Again, you have the music of the Go-Go's, a couple of Belinda Carlisle songs thrown in there as well. A really interesting element that, at least from my perspective, is the most effective numbers were not necessarily the hits. The creative staff includes people that were behind the Broadway production of Hedwig and the Angry Inch, behind Spring Awakenings. Director Michael Mayer did one of my favorite pieces of theater direction ever, which was American Idiot. So you have some top-notch people involved in this, a great cast, and for you, Bryan and Steve, you drag race people, one of the principals is Peppermint.
Oh, yeah.
Yep. With this role, she will be the first trans woman actress to create a principal role on Broadway. It's currently in previews, as I mentioned. Its opening is set for July 26th. And if you are in the New York area, I strongly encourage you to see this. Big time LGBT content in this one as well. Just a wonderful time. Okay, we're going to wrap this one up now that we've gone through the Wolves of the Week. Again, we are the Comic Book Bears Podcast. You can find us on the Facebook as Comic Book Bears Podcast. You can find us on the Twitter and the Tumblr and the Instagram as Comic Book Bears. If you want to reach out to us, you can always do so by sending an email to comicbookbears@gmail.com. And if you want to listen to us, naturally you can go through iTunes or through Stitcher Radio or Podbean. So until next time, I'm Billy Z.
I'm Bryan Pittard.
And I'm Steve Morey.
You're going to hear a wolf and an explosion, and we'll be back real soon. Take care, everyone.
Wolf!
I should have told you all I wanted was to have some fun. But you wanted me to be the permanent one. Yes, it did. Now when we're in the movies or the back of the car, you always stop me when I go too far. I should have known you'd always keep me waiting for those wedding bells. Those wedding bells. Oh, we could talk on. But you won't understand. The only words you want to hear are, do you take this man? Does the love and conversation mean the pennies dropping? You should have known that I was only window shopping. It's my clumsy way of saying.